Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum. I feel like I finally made it here after two really long attempts to get here that ended up in failure because of the weather. And even though I left at 2:30, it took me 3 hours to get here. The traffic is unbelievable. So I feel very happy to be here. And then I discovered that Dr. Takim and I actually go back a long way, that we met when I was just 19 years old as an undergraduate in Charlotte School. We crossed paths. I had suspected that, and so I was happy to confirm that that was the case. So in many ways, it's nice to be back with old friends, and Dr. Haddara already mentioned that we have a previous connection. So it's really my pleasure and relief in many ways to be here. It's my honor to be given this opportunity to speak to you in this context. And you know, we thank the Emir of Sharjah for establishing this chair and providing an opportunity, a forum for us to discuss important issues about Islam and the world. And so tonight I want to speak to you about my thoughts on ISIS, right? And I don't want to sort of speak about ISIS in terms of it's the graphic granular detail of their atrocities, but I want to speak more conceptually about where one can place ISIS in a sort of a broader sweep or grand sweep of political theology in the Islamic tradition, and specifically in the Sunni tradition. And what I mean by political theology is how theological assumptions inform the practice of politics and establish criteria of legitimacy for political action, right? And I don't want to get into details about whether all politics is theological ultimately or not, but I do want to just focus right now on the Islamic tradition and the political theology that emerges out of Islam. And the problem of political theology in Islam emerges immediately upon the death of the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? So while the Prophet was alive, there was really no dispute that Muslims should follow the Prophet, right? But as we know, upon his death, the Muslim community and numerous divisions arose within the community about how authority should be structured after his death. And so there are different kinds of generic solutions that one can imagine, and one can find them in different strands of the Muslim community. The one what I would call messianism, right, is the idea of a charismatic kind of leader, a leader that has a special attribute that distinguishes him or her from the rest of the community, that allows that person to gain unique access to divine knowledge. And because this person possesses unique access to divine knowledge, that entitles that person to leadership in the community. Now, of course, this idea is most famously associated with Shiism, right? The different branches of Shiism. But it's not limited to Shiism. There were various Sunni groups, particularly certain kinds of Sufi groups, that were similar conceptually to this idea. Their belief that the sheikh, the saint, right, had this special access, and that kind of charismatic access gave the saint the moral right, sometimes even the political right, to lead the community. So that's one option that Islamic political theology allows the Muslim community. Another option is similar to it, in a sense, because it seeks to solve the problem of leadership by also having a leader that is, in one way or another, different in his sort of moral perfections than everybody else. But unlike the charismatic view that, you know, we're looking for the leader who's been designated by God with this special gift, this other view I sort of call the puritanical view, which rests in the idea that there will be the most virtuous person. We can rank order people in the community from the least virtuous to the most virtuous, and we should follow the most virtuous, right? The most virtuous person in the community is entitled to our support by virtue of his or her virtue, right? And upon doing something that impeaches that virtue, the community has to remove that leader and place another one in his stead, right? And so this tendency is associated in the tradition with the Khawarij, the Kharijis, right? So the Kharijis believed that any person in the community could be the leader, provided that he was the most virtuous member of the community. But that virtue, the superior virtue, had to continue not only from the time that he became ruler, but throughout his term. And as soon as he lost that distinction, the community had an obligation to overthrow him and replace him with the newly discovered most virtuous leader. Neither of these two solutions was the one that the Sunni theologians adopted. Right? I want to argue instead that the Sunnis try to imagine authority in the post-prophetic world as residing in two things, in the law that the Prophet Muhammad brought to the community, and a community of individuals of average moral integrity, what we call in fiqh adala udul, right? And so the idea was that a community made up of people of perfectly average integrity, right? Because integrity was not deemed to be a superhuman quality, but rather something within the capacity of every single person. Right? And by virtue of their knowledge of the law, which again, the assumption among Sunnis, was that knowledge of divine law was accessible to every single person on an equal basis, right? You know, again, assuming average intelligence, etc. Right? So the average person had access to divine law and had the capability of having the integrity necessary to adhere to the divine law. Right? And so a community such as this was perfectly capable of self-government. Right? That's why for the Sunnis, the problem of political authority in the wake of the Prophet was to be resolved by choice, ikhtiyar. So according to the Sunni theologians, we choose our own leaders. But this choice is not arbitrary. We're not free to choose anybody we wish, because the assumption is the electorate, so to speak, or the community, is made up of the people that I described earlier, namely people who are motivated to follow revealed law, the divine law of Islam, and have the integrity to do so more often than not. So such a community will choose leadership that displays certain attributes of knowledge and integrity and competence. Right? So far from demanding a standard of perfection, the Sunni political theology simply required integrity along with accountability. So these two things go hand in hand. So if the community is made up of the average individual who is not immune from mistakes or sins, right, who's capable of committing crimes, but at the same time is capable also of obeying the law, right, then we have to have an idea of sin that is non-exclusionary. Right? So in the early community, there's a lot of theological dispute about the status of the major sinner. Right? So for the Sunnis, the solution that the Sunnis eventually came to accept was the idea that sin could not exclude one from the community. Right? One only left the community by repudiating explicitly what brought one into the community. So just as one can only become a Muslim by testifying that there is no God except God and Muhammad is his prophet, one can only leave the community by expressly repudiating that. Anything other than that, no matter what sort of moral sins you committed, you were still a member of the community. In other words, you can't be excommunicated based on sin. Right? Now, in some ways, could look at it as this is an extremely tolerant standard of belonging, or you could look at it as an extremely permissive standard of belonging. But what I want to argue is the reason why Sunni theologians could adopt this view was because they assumed the presence of a state that would hold people accountable for their breaches of the law. This is a very key assumption that they have. Yes, we say that major sinners are still a part of the community, and yes, we hope that God will forgive them, but the potential or the possibility that God will forgive them does not mean that they escape accountability in this life, right? So you have this position that you hold simultaneously that the sinner may very well be forgiven in the next life, but in this life he must be held accountable for his breaches of the law, right? So therefore, membership in the community is brought about by proper belief, okay? And it's only, you only remove yourself from a community by express repudiation of that belief. Your conduct, insofar as you fall short of the standards of integrity, are never sufficient to exclude you from the community. Rather, there's always the hope of the perfection of the miscreant, right? That the idea is the sinner can improve over time, so to speak, right? And so that's why you have this idea in among Sunni theologians that iman wa yazidu wa yanqus, that iman increases and decreases, right? The idea is that the sinner can be rehabilitated over time, so therefore that should not be a ground for exclusion. But it doesn't eliminate the requirement for some kind of system of integrity in this world, right? That demand for accountability ultimately is what will give rise to the perceived necessity of having a state. But in contrast to more messianic or charismatic conceptions of leadership on the one hand, and pietistic, puritanical conceptions of leadership on the other hand, for the Sunnis, knowledge and integrity and good order were sufficient for the survival of the religious community into the future. You didn't need to have perfect leadership, right? And this shows up in lots of detailed rules. Most famously, what the jurists or the theologians say, jawaz imamat al-mafdool, right? So the Sunnis say, in contrast to other theological groups, that it's permissible for the community to appoint the less virtuous to positions of authority. But the key word here is mafdool. So for those of you who know Arabic, it's the passive participle from the root fa'dalanj, which means virtue. Now, the less virtuous, according to them, implies a minimal level of virtue, right? So again, it's not that anybody can become a leader. So the community can't appoint a criminal, right? But they can appoint somebody who is not as virtuous as somebody else, right? As long as he satisfies that minimum quantum of virtue, right? So you knowledge, integrity, and a minimum and a certain level of virtue, but not an overly demanding standard of virtue, right? Which is appropriate, as I said, if you view this as the authority of the common person. Okay, well, where does the state fit in Sunni thought? So unlike, let's say, certain charismatic political theologies, Sunnis deny that the state is salvific, right? Even though Sunnis will argue that the state is necessary, it's an obligation upon the community to establish a state, the obligation is not connected to salvation, right? In the way that, like, for example, testifying that there's no God except God, Muhammad is his prophet, or praying, etc., etc. Those are sort of religious obligations, which are distinct and have salvific qualities to them that politics does not, right? So why then should a community that denies that proper politics is a part of salvation nevertheless insist on it, right? And so, I mean, again, this is interesting. If you look at later Sunni kalam books, like a 14th century theologian like Tafkazani, and others as well, they will include the imamate, the caliphate, in theology books. But then they say, this is really not a topic of theology. It's really more properly a topic of law, but we've included it in theology because we have to rebut the views of other groups who think that it is, in fact, a proper part of doctrine. Right? Nevertheless, Sunnis say it's a legal obligation, right? It's a legal obligation, non-waivable legal obligation. Why? Well, because I think the argument, or the way to understand the Sunni position, is that although the state is not in and of itself salvific, it's a condition for salvation. In other words, it's impossible to live a religious life according to the law if there's not a state. So this is an argument that the 11th century theologian Abu Hamid al-Ghazali makes in his text Al-Iqtisad fil-Ihtiqad. So in laying out his proof for the obligation of the imamate, he says that there's no dispute, no Muslim would dispute, that Muslims are under an obligation to establish the good order of religion. Right? Because without the good order of religion, it would be impossible to live as a Muslim and be impossible to obtain salvation. But it's impossible to obtain the good order of the good order of religion without first obtaining the good order of the world. And so his interlocutor says, wait a second. Salvation comes at the expense of the world. Because as believers, we're supposed to shun the world. So how can it possibly be true that the good order of religion depends on the good order of the world? And so he explains that the goals of religion can only be achieved if people are secure in their worldly life, meaning they have enough food, they have shelter, they have clothing, they have companionship, which he calls sort of necessities of human life, right? Because only if you have these basic necessities, these sort of secular necessities, can then one pursue higher things, namely pursue study and worship. Because religion, for him, is discharged through reflection and through worship. And unless you achieve these basic necessities of life, you're not going to be able to achieve these other things. And then he says, experience teaches us that if you don't have good order in the secular world, it's impossible to achieve any of these secular necessities that would enable you to live a religious life. Right? Therefore, he argues, or he concludes, the good order of religion is contingent on the good order of the world. So the good order of the world is precedent to the good order of religion. So that's his argument in his theological treatise, Al-Iqtisad. He also has another, it's not so much an argument, but rather an analogy, which is very interesting, in his book, Ihya' al-Din, which is a work of ethics. And there, in the very first chapter of that book, which is called the Book of Science, of Sciences, where he's giving a division of the sciences, right? So it begins by dividing all sciences into revealed sciences and rational sciences and worldly sciences and revealed sciences. And he classifies revealed knowledge of the revealed law, fiqh, as a worldly science, not as an otherworldly science. And again, here the interlocutor is quite surprised. How can you say that knowledge of the revealed law is a worldly science, right? When it teaches haram and halal and all these things, and this is how you have to behave, so that and so it must be an otherworldly science. Right? He says no. People confuse knowledge of the law with an otherworldly with the affairs of spirituality in the next life. Because the affairs of this world are intermingled with the affairs of this life. Because it's impossible to reach the goal of salvation in the next life without, you know, passing through this life. And your passage through this life requires some kind of order, right? So there's a, it's impossible to separate this life from the next, because temporally, this life precedes the next life. And your position or your fate in the next life will depend entirely on how you conduct yourself in this life. But you can't confuse the two. Sciences of the next life are focused on inner states and inner being. Those are the things that are valuable and earn you reward in the next life. But the rules of the law are simply concerned with organizing this life and preventing injustice and conflict. And so one can't the science of the next life can't dispense with the rules of justice in this life. But that doesn't mean the two are the same thing at all, because their ends are very different. Right? Their ends are very different. So the analogy he proposed that he uses to explain this relationship to his interlocutor is that of the pilgrimage caravan. So, as I'm sure many of you know, one of the fundamental pillars of Islam is going on pilgrimage to Mecca. Now, in his day, going to Mecca was very dangerous. I don't know if it was dangerous to be in Mecca. Today it might be the reverse. But going to Mecca was very dangerous, right? And so, in fact, one of the conditions that had to be satisfied before it was an obligation to go was something that Jews called amn al-tariq, that the highway had to be safe, right? Because there were bandits. And if you couldn't assure that your travel was safe, then you weren't obliged to go. So the way that you protected yourself was to hire guards. And the guards would protect the caravan of pilgrims on the way to the Hijaz. So he says, it's obvious to anyone who thinks about it that having guards is a condition to go to successfully completing your pilgrimage. But the science of guardianship, of protection, is completely different than the knowledge of what pilgrimage entails, even though one, namely completion of the pilgrimage, is dependent on the other. Right? Nobody would confuse what's required to be understood so that you can protect the caravan with the knowledge of actually conducting pilgrimage. And the same is true about the rules of law to the hereafter and salvation in the hereafter. The two can't be conflated, even though they're intermixed. Because their ends are completely different, right? Their methods are different, right? And the way we talk about them must be considered different. Okay? So, for Ghazali, the ends of the law are to organize this life and to establish the good order of this life. Not necessarily, they're not in and of themselves salvific. They help create the conditions for salvation in the future by enabling us to live a religiously ennobled life. The same kind of idea, although expressed differently, is found in the 14th century Andalusian jurist Ash-Shatibi. Again, this is going to the idea that the good order of this world is a condition precedent to living a proper religious life. So he says the following, that the Sharia, Islam's revealed law, prohibits categorically public officials from pursuing any private interests vis-a-vis their offices, right? So he says, that's why it's forbidden for a ruler to demand a wage from the population in exchange for work for functioning as a ruler. Likewise, it's illegal for a judge to demand a wage from the litigants before he judges, or a mufti to demand a wage from his petitioner, right, et cetera, et cetera. And he says the reason for this is because public officials, these public offices, the wilayat al-amma, right, have to exist solely for the benefit of the population that they serve. Once they are undermined by the seeking of private ends, right? There's nothing left to these offices, right? So if you have judges who seek judicial office in order to enrich themselves, or rulers who seek public office in order, again, to enrich themselves, then the entire purpose for these offices is destroyed and undermined. And interestingly, he says that if this happens, right, that would destroy the basic foundations of Islam. Right? So he says, and this is a universal rule. وَعَلَى right? هَذَا فِي جَمِيعِ الْأَنَامِ And in this rule of basic justice is universal to all humanity. وَيَصْلُحَ النِّظَامِ And it's only in this way that there can be good order, i.e. when public offices are discharged for the benefit of the public. وَعَلَى خِلَافِهِ يَجْرِ الْجَوْرُ فِي الْأَحْكَامِ And when the opposite takes place, what we have is unjust law. الْجَوْرُ فِي الْأَحْكَامِ وَهَدْمُ قَوَاعَدِ الْإِسْلَامِ So once you have corruption in public office, then that's what threatens the foundations of Islam. Okay? Now it's interesting here because he clearly understands that sins, venial sins, one say, drinking, drug taking, illicit sex, etc., are clearly major sins. But they don't threaten Islam. Right? They don't threaten Islam because these are individual shortcomings. Remember, we talked about the idea that in Sunni Islam, the major sinner is rehabilitated and potentially forgiven by God. So these aren't really the focus of his concern. Rather, the focus of his concern is integrity in public offices. Right? Without integrity in public offices, the very existence of the community is threatened. Now, what I've explained so far is kind of the ideal theory of Sunni Islam. That doesn't mean historically it was satisfied. In fact, there were lots and lots of compromises, right? So, although in principle, Sunni political theology said that the community should choose its leaders, iftiyah, through some sort of voluntary process, in practice, it became dominated, or the practical rule was that of military conquest. Whoever was strong, whatever claimant had the strength to claim rule and to seize rule, basically became the ruler, and then he basically got to organize the state until the state lost its strength and another person came and overthrew him. Nevertheless, jurists, I argue, tried to vindicate the basic principles of their ideal system by virtue of the fact that they never accorded full legitimacy to usurpers. What I mean by that is although they recognized a general duty, or although they were willing to retroactively recognize the legitimacy of usurpers, meaning somebody who took over by force, right, what they weren't willing to do was to give usurpers an automatic pass in what they do subsequent to their usurpation. Right? So everything that a usurper did had to be tested for legality. Right? So there was a very important principle in Sunni fiqh called لا طاعة لمخلوق في معصية الخالق, that there is no duty of obedience in disobedience to the Creator. Right? So if a usurper commanded us to commit a sin, for example, to kill someone unjustly, we had an obligation to refuse that duty, to refuse that command. Because such a command is illegal, right? And it doesn't matter if it's coming from the Sultan or whoever, whatever you want to call him, right? Because the minute a public official does something, commands something that requires you to commit a sin, he's just like any other private person. And if a private person commanded you to kill somebody, the Sharia obliges you to say no. Even if you have to die, right? So the Sharia never allows a Muslim to kill another because he's threatened with the loss of his own life, right? Because lives are equal, right? So there's no such thing as a necessity defense to murder, right? So this principle was recognized by the Muslim jurists, and it was used, at least theoretically, to limit the kinds of power, or the exercise of power, even by usurpers. Now, I would argue that it's likely that this set of values actually had an important effect in limiting the kinds of arbitrary exercises of power in Islamic states up until toward the end of the 19th century, when the institutional structure of Sunnism and Islamic law collapsed. In response to the pressures of colonialism, the Ottomans adopted various reforms known as the Tanzimat. Again, I don't want to blame the Tanzimat for things, but the important point is the institutional structure that allowed Islamic law to exercise a meaningful system of accountability, not just for rulers, but also for other lawbreakers, collapses in the 19th century under the pressure of colonialism for lots of reasons, not simply because of the importation of European codes or anything like that, but just more generally, the Ottoman Empire lost control over its own territory as a state became more and more enfeebled and unable to exercise its responsibilities, and as a result, lawlessness sort of spread, right? Regardless of our judgment as to whether or not the Tanzimat were a good idea, the ability of the Ottoman state to apply its own laws was decreasing. And as a result, the Ottoman Sultan began to claim more and more absolutist centralizing powers, right? Because the idea was, or the rationale was, I can't trust people in the provinces. I have to monopolize power myself, right? In order to be able to push reforms, et cetera, et cetera. In practice, that only led to more and more arbitrary decision making. And so in the wake of the collapse of the Ottoman Empire at the end of World War I, there grew a lot of dissatisfaction with the institutional structures that existed in the Ottoman Empire at the end of the 19th century and early 20th century. Rashid Rida wrote a book called Al-Khilafah Al-Uzma, basically a treatise about the caliphate and how it could be revived. And his argument was that istibdad, autocracy, had debilitated the Muslim community and made it incapable of resisting colonialism. And this istibdad was of two sorts. The first was political autocracy of the sort that we saw exercised by the Ottoman Sultan or the Ottoman government, which it would command and prohibit based on its own opinion without consulting people in the community and expect them to obey. Right? And then the second kind, which was perhaps even more debilitating, was what he called religious autocracy or religious despotism. And this was encapsulated or manifested in the doctrine of taqlid, deference. So Rashid Rida and others, like Muhammad Abdu and other reformers of the 19th and 20th century, launched a long polemic and campaign against the idea of taqlid. That Muslims, taqlid basically says that non-specialists have an obligation in matters of law to defer to specialists. And so in the Sunni context, there were four established doctrines of law, the Malikis, the Hanafis, the Shafi'is, and the Hanbalis. And so you were obliged to follow one of these, right? And in the case of the Ottoman Empire, it was to follow the Hanafi madhab. And so Rida and others were extreme in their attacks against taqlid and argued for the opening of the gates of ijtihad and said that if Muslims want to progress, they have to rely on their own independent reasoning, right? And reject taqlid, blind imitation of the past, in order that they can adapt to modern needs. Now, it's very important, because lots of times people call Rashid Rida a Salafi. Yes, he was a Salafi, but in a very, very different sense than the way Salafi is used today. Because Rida argued for following the Salaf, not the Salaf being the first generation of Muslims, not as a theological obligation. He did not claim that Muslims had an obligation to do taqlid of the first generation of Muslims, because he was against taqlid. Rather, he was saying, look, the Salaf didn't practice taqlid. They practiced independent judgment, right? They were open to new ideas, right? They were practical about the problems that they faced. They weren't slavish adherents to text. They always thought about the public good in the way that they applied Islamic law. So when he called himself a Salafi, that's what he meant. He did not mean that we should stop doing taqlid of the madahib and do taqlid of the Salaf, right? But unfortunately, his name has become associated with later developments of Salafism, which out of which ISIS grows, which is in fact a theological doctrine regarding the obligation of Muslims to follow the early community, on the theory that the early community is the ideal, perfect Muslim community. And so we have an obligation to imitate them in all sorts of ways whenever we can. I want to get to that a little later. But the point about Rida, which was very interesting, was that he did not reject taqlid in toto. He did not say that it was sinful to engage in taqlid. His argument against taqlid was that it was not practical. That if Muslims wanted to reform their societies, become modern societies, be able to live as equals with the West, they had to abandon this method of lawmaking. They had to adopt modern methods of lawmaking through deliberation and legislation. So much of his argument in the book Al-Khilafah is devoted to saying that we need to have new ijtihad in the form of parliaments, right? Not in the kind of taqlid, not in the kind of traditional mode where you have a jurist read texts and derive a fatwa from it. See, that's not because that's sinful, right? As Salafis later would say, to follow the opinions of ijtihad and do taqlid. No, the reason why is because in Islamic principles of jurisprudence, usul al-fiqh, if you are not a mujtahid, you are free to accept the opinion of the mufti or to reject it, whether you do tasdeeq or takdeeb. And so he says, because the individual person is free, is only required to follow a fatwa to the extent that he believes it to be true, as long as we practice ijtihad in the traditional way, We can never establish general law that can reform our societies. The only way to reform society is by having a legislature and a modern state that can pass general law. Interpreted law is always subjective, and people can reject it or accept it based on their own subjective belief of its conformity with God's will. And so that won't work as a matter of politics. So Rida's critique of the madhab system is political, not theological. Again, this distinguishes him radically from the people who call themselves Salafis today. They reject taqlid not because of the political consequences of it, but they believe that it's sinful for a Muslim to follow the opinions of another, because Muslims are obligated to follow God and His Prophet. And so by following the opinion of a mujtahid, they're practicing a certain kind of shirk, associationalism, right? And so therefore, it's prohibited, right? That's not Rida's position at all. Now there's another kind of taqlid that Rida warns the Muslim community about, which is very important, which also is taken up by later Salafis, but then applied in a very radically different way. So, sorry, I thought this was off. I can't turn off my blinder. Anyway, so Rida says that just as we need to free ourselves from religious despotism, the taqlid of history, so to speak, we also can't fall into another kind of taqlid, which he identifies as blind adherence to European tradition. So I know that we have Iranian guests. So it's the same kind of idea that becomes famous in Iran under the word Gharbzadeh, West-struckenness, right? So Rida is very concerned that a lot of modern Muslims in his day rightly reject what the ulama are teaching them about Islam. They are right to reject it. But instead of reforming these mistaken conceptions of Islam, they then go do the opposite extreme and just blindly imitate Europe. Now, to be clear, Ridha is not against following Europe in lots of things, right? But what he's concerned about is adopting European customs and morals without any critical sense. So he readily admits that Muslims need to follow European methods of legislation and politics, right? Because he said, it's obvious that one of the reasons why Europe has advanced is because of their constitutional government. So we would be silly not to adopt constitutional government. Likewise, they've advanced because of science and technology. We would be silly if we didn't pursue science and technology, right? But we have no reason to adopt Western art forms, for example. So he gives the example of building statues or statues of public figures. So apparently there are some statues built of public figures in Turkey, or I know there's some in Egypt as well. And he says, this is an example of bad taqlid. Not because it's sinful in and of itself. He doesn't think that there's any prohibition against Muslims in doing sculpture. He just says it's motivated by wrong reasons. Right? It's motivated by the desire to have Europe accept us, instead of motivated by the desire of what is good for us. Right? So if any of you study political theory, this is similar to the kind of concerns that someone like Jean-Jacques Rousseau has about the difference between amour propre, which is the kind of self-love that one has based on what others think of him, as opposed to amour de soi, true love of self. Love of self based on knowledge of what is good for oneself, right? So true knowledge of what is of true love based on what is good for oneself is good and healthy, right? But love of self in the other way, where you're only concerned about how others think of you, that is a kind of love of self that leads to degradation and debasement. Because instead of thinking of what's good for you, you think of how others perceive you and you act on that basis, right? Now, what I would argue here is that Ridha and the whole line of reasoning and critique in the late 19th and 20th century of Muslim reformists successfully demolished the early modern, late medieval equilibrium of Sunni political theology. But it failed completely in establishing a new one. Right? So for reformers like Ridha, the hope was establishing genuine constitutional government, where you would have limited government, and you would have some sort of collective deliberation about the content of what divine law was. Right? But instead, for reasons that we can't get into here, that constructive project failed. But the deconstructive project succeeded all too well, right? So Ridha and Abdu and the other reformers succeeded all too well in stripping legitimacy from the pre-modern tradition among lay Muslims. And unfortunately, what's filled the gap is a kind of theological Salafism that I've alluded to at other times in the talk, and now I want to speak to very briefly, as I see I'm running out of time. Now, what's happened is that in place of the sophisticated theological and juridical tradition that characterized Sunni theology and Sunni law prior to the 20th century, now we have a very egalitarian, but for lack of a better term, simple-minded kind of literalist theology that has spread among particularly the Arabic-speaking Sunni world. And this is a result of lots of different factors, not least of which is the spread of mass literacy. So now people have access to books that they could have never seen in their lives before. The collapse of an independent religious elite that could act as a kind of qualified interpreter of the tradition, right? And what you have now is a world which, in some senses, was feared by some of the earliest Sunni authorities. So when, in the second Islamic century, when the Ahl al-Hadith movement sort of began to grow in strength, you have jurists like Abu Yusuf, the student of Abu Hanifa, and Malik ibn Anas, expressing concern about the spread of Hadith. Not that they were against Hadith, not like the conclusion like some Orientalists draw that they didn't believe Hadith was normative. No, what they were concerned about was that individual texts of Hadith reflected a very partial teaching. And they distinguished between Sunnah, which was a general norm, a norm of general applicability, and a particular narration, Hadith, which might be evidence for that norm. But there were many cases where early Sunni mujtahids, like Malik, Abu Hanifa, would accept the historicity of a particular narration, but then reject it in terms of its normativity, right? Because they understood that individual hadiths, in and of themselves, did not give a complete normative picture of the teaching. That hadiths on their own could represent a very partial memory, or very partial transmission of the entire doctrine, right? So there was a certain suspicion of individual hadith. So you see this in the Maliki doctrine of Amal Ahl al-Madinah, the practice of the community of Medina. So Malik would reject even Sahih hadiths if they were inconsistent with the practice of Medina. And the Hanafis, the early Hanafis, had a doctrine called Umum al-Balwa, where the issue is general and universal for the entire Muslim community, and the Muslim community practices in a certain way, and then there's an individual hadith that is contradictory to it. Well, we may not know exactly why, but there must be something wrong with that hadith, even if the isnad is valid, et cetera, right? Because by presumption of the integrity of the Muslim community, it would be impossible that everybody is doing something contrary to the genuine teaching of the Prophet, right? So these madhabs had built in kinds of editorial checks, for lack of a better term, for screening the normativity of even what appear to be historically valid memories. So you can think of this, the whole project of fiqh and its sophisticated theories of sources and analogy and ends, maqasid, amma, etc., negotiate a way between history, between memory of the past, and normative ideals. Salafism destroys this. Salafism claims to abandon any kind of attempt to create a rational structure for Islamic law, and says that all we do is follow texts wherever they take us, right? And so that each text is an asl by itself, is a principle by itself, right? So, and they will quote, you know, various people sort of again out of context, like for example, Imam Shafi'i has this famous statement, my doctrine is whatever the Sahih Hadith is, right? Now, that's quoted a lot, but of course the Shafi'is never followed that. They said you always have to judge Hadith by what the Imam taught, but that's not here or there. But the 20th century was characterized by an immense amount of work by Salafi intellectuals to sort of clear the underbrush of the pre-modern tradition and give access to the entire Muslim world to pure access to unmediated texts. So for example, the Muhaddith al-Albani, he has this massive project to purge the entire Hadith corpus of what he considered to be weak Hadiths. Because if he did that, in his opinion, then he would be left with pure Islam, right? And then everybody could just follow pure Islam without having to engage in any kind of intellectual reflection. ISIS emerges out of this, and then becomes wedded, to make things sort of worse, with apocalyptic traditions, apocalyptic teachings in the tradition, which again, I am not aware of, I've never encountered before, where There are, of course, apocalyptic statements found in the traditions attributed to the Prophet Muhammad, and of course, theologians commented on them, but they were never taken as a basis for law. And so one of the most infamous practices of ISIS, of course, has been the reviving slave women. And so I was sort of thought this was really, really bizarre, right? And so I tried to do a little bit of research to try to figure out what their explanation for this was. And what they cited was a hadith. It's a very famous hadith. Most people have probably encountered it because it's among the 40 famous hadiths that Imam Nawawi has, right? It's the hadith, what is Islam, what is Iman, etc., etc. And then at the end, it says, what are the signs of the Day of Judgment? And the Prophet says, well, the one being asked doesn't know more about it than the one asking. But then the Prophet mentions a few things. And one of the things he says is an enigmatic statement, أَنْتَذِرْ أَمَتُ سَيِّدَهُ, that the slave girl shall give birth to her master. Okay. Now, historically speaking, several jurists actually believed that this prophecy had already been fulfilled. Right? So in Islamic law, if a slave girl gave birth to a child, then she no longer was a slave. Right? She was called Umwad, the mother of a child. Right? And so the jurists said, this was a prediction of the conquests after the Prophet's death, and that there would be captives taken, and the captives would give birth to their masters, and then they would be set free as a result. So it's a metaphor for the fact that the child sets free the mother, and in that way acts as her master. But ISIS, as an apocalyptic movement, now takes this as something that has to be realized in the here and now, because their goal is to bring about the Day of Judgment, or to bring about the end days. Right? So this apocalyptic tendency in ISIS, right, is driving much of the way they interpret or the way they practice their Salafism. Obviously not all Salafis become like ISIS, but Salafism was a precondition, I think, for ISIS to arise. But it wasn't simply, it's not a sufficient condition, and this is where I want to conclude. As I tried to say earlier in the talk, Sunnism was predicated, always demanded, the existence of an institutional structure of accountability. But the great tragedy of the Arab world, and as I said, that you know, the reformers had a constructive project, not just a deconstructive one. But the constructive project did not work, it did not succeed. Instead of having constitutional government in the Arab world, instead we had new despotisms. In fact, despotisms much worse than the Ottoman despotism, right? And so it's this lethal combination of a collapse of a rational tradition of religion and its replacement by sort of an explicitly anti-rationalist tradition of religion, along with, right, a political environment of extreme despotism that has given birth to apocalyptic religious movements. And so ISIS is not the product simply of bad theology. It's also, I would say, even more a product of the bad politics of the Arab world since the end of World War I, especially World War II. And this is, I think, what's very depressing, is that I agree with President Obama that sooner or later ISIS will be defeated because ISIS has nothing to offer. So I don't necessarily view ISIS as a terribly great threat politically, but it does present a profound theological challenge, particularly for the Sunni world, because the Sunni world, the whole political theology of Sunni Islam was dependent on the idea that the community could govern itself in a responsible fashion, right? But the experience of the 20th century is casting real doubts on that, right? And hence we have the existence, or the coming into existence, of apocalyptic movements. And I'm afraid that I can't see an end to that in the near future. Thank you.
Okay, well, I must confess that when I saw how much you wanted to do the general sweep, I wasn't sure you could finish in time, but you did. It's an amazing job. A lot of ground covered, a lot of food for thought. I was very glad to see that a lot of people were taking very careful notes. So hopefully, despite the breadth of the conversation, we can still have questions and further the conversation. So the floor is open. Sorry, and the microphone is working. So you can use the microphone or you can speak from your seat. We can hear you. Questions, yes.
I wanted you to elaborate more on the Sykes-Picot, or whatever that is.
Oh, okay.
Can you repeat the question?
She wanted me to elaborate more on the Sykes-Picot. Well, it's not very difficult to elaborate more since I didn't mention it at all. The Sykes-Picot agreement was an agreement between England and France, pursuant to which they divided secretly, they agreed to divide the Arab possessions of the Ottoman Empire into French zones of influence and English, British zones of influence. And of course, ultimately that also led to the creation of Israel as a Jewish state. Of course, that was, highly problematic from the perspective of the political ambitions of the Arabs of the region, right? Until the end of the Ottoman Empire, right? Most Arabs, despite what you would hear from Jordan, were loyal to the idea of the Ottoman Empire and wanted a reformed Ottoman Empire. They didn't want the destruction of the Ottoman Empire. They wanted a reformed Ottoman Empire and assumed that they would continue to exist as one political community. And so when the Ottomans were defeated and the Ottoman Empire came to an end, they were completely unprepared, right? Not simply that it was a great psychological shock because they'd been part of the Ottoman Empire for almost 500 years, but they really had not made any contingency plans for the idea of how they would exist as independent political communities. So I think that also is the lack of preparation for life as independent nation states was also, I think, contributed greatly to the failures of the Arab reform project of the Nakba of the 20th century, which is again, it helps explain why, despite the rejection of despotism as a political ideal, the only thing the Arabs got after World War I was despotism. Yes,
hi. Do you think that the motivation behind ISIS is gaining power because of the volatile region and just advantage of the conditions of that area and the desperate needs that people are experiencing, or perhaps they are actually trying to reform Sunni leadership and just have a misguided understanding of what Islam essence is?
Well, I think it's all of those, right? Because of the catastrophic political situation, right? And the inherent human need for a state and order, right? There is obviously a movement to try to provide it, but the movement's taken an apocalyptic turn because of the immediate theological, intellectual, and political history that's preceded this breakdown of order, right? So it could have been something else. It could have been something like the Khmer Rouge in Cambodia. Right? But it's taken this form because of the particularities of the region. But the most important thing, of course, is the 100 years of political failure, right? And so that's what really needs to be addressed. I mean, I don't think that you can defeat ISIS theologically, right? You need to address the political conditions, exactly like Imam Ghazali said, the good order of the world precedes the good order of religion. If you have chaos in the world, you're going to have chaos in religion.
Following on that, then is it incumbent upon, I guess, the countries that are not being attacked by ISIS to provide that kind of structure, to provide that kind of political growth, or is that kind of growth where you're looking to find that within ISIS?
I'm very pessimistic about the prospects of ISIS becoming something good, right? But unfortunately, I'm also very pessimistic about the Arab state order, right? And so what I would say is Arabs deserve a choice other than ISIS or Sisi. There has to be something else, right? It can't be either ISIS, or I mean, pick whatever you want. I like Sisi because it's like a reversal of the name of the letters. But there has to be a different choice between ISIS and, you know, King Salman, whoever you want to choose. We can't have just be our choices can't be limited to this despotism or that despotism, right? There has to be something else. And I think, you know, the reform project of the 19th, 20th century gives a place to build from. They were trying to establish constitutional limited government, right, that was based in an important way on popular participation, in which we would not be limited in our options by clerical interpretations of religion, right? But at the same time, would have a meaningful normative connection to Islam. Now, it seems to me that that is a practical way to go forward, but the political order of the Arab world is completely against any kind of popular participation, it seems to me. And that, as long as that's the case, we're going to have to live with ISIS.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, I was
wondering. Could we ask somebody else?
Yes.
Yeah. I think there are other questions.
Okay, let's go down. Sorry, I didn't see your hand. I actually looked. Sorry.
Yeah. My question is this: do we know for sure who, if any, is a scholar, quote unquote, who has given birth to ISIS or their philosophy?
Well, like I said, I don't think there's one. But what's happened over the course of the 20th century was that the historical method of interpretation, which tried to always, whose goal was always to reconcile history with certain rational ideals in the present, has been completely demolished. Right? And what's taken its place is a pure desire for fidelity to an imagined historical community. And that's the product of a lot of individuals. Of course, you know, most of them, we would say, are inspired by the Saudi state in one way or the other, right? As a practical matter. But it's not limited to them. It's a position that finds a lot of resonance among average people. Because who is going to say to a Muslim, oh, you shouldn't do what the Prophet did, or you shouldn't do what the early community did? Because, as I said before in other circumstances, every Sunni to a certain extent is a Salafi in the sense that they view the early community as a model. What makes modern Salafism unique is that they say that we are supposed to follow them as an ideal, right? As opposed to trying to always reconcile our memories of the community with the present. So there's no desire at all to reconcile this history with the present. So I mentioned this problem of what Rida said about taqlid of Europe as a bad thing. Now, I forgot to say the postscript to that was that just as Salafis took his criticism of religious despotism in a direction that he couldn't have imagined, they also took his criticism of imitation of Europe in a direction he completely couldn't imagine. So they've taken this position that we should reject Europe as like one of their foundational theological principles. So if you read some Salafi theologies, they have this doctrine they call wala wa bara, with loyalty and disavowal. So that a Muslim should be loyal only to Muslims and should disavow, actually have some sort of hidden psychological distance at a minimum, if not outright hatred for non-Muslims, right? And they make this into one of their higher theological principles, right? They call it wala wa bara, right? And this is something that could have never come out of the mouth of somebody like Rashid Rida. Because Rida, again, if you read the book Al-Khilafa, what he says, he specifically warns the Turks, right, that you know you need to have a reformed Islam that is humanist in the sense that it's capable of helping the world achieve a universal human brotherhood and not be a kind of Islamic chauvinism, right? But the way they fetishize walat wa bara is a kind of extreme rejection of the other, whereas Rida was saying, we should only reject the other to the extent that we're imitating him, not because it's good for us, but because we want the other to like us, without thinking of our own good, right? So Rida warned against blind deference to Europe, but he never taught anything about sort of blind rejection of them, either on principle. But Salafism sort of nurtured that into something much, much, much different and much more toxic than he could have ever imagined.
We still have time for a couple more questions, so we will keep going with this discussion until I just take a direct follow-up on this.
Yes, follow-up.
Okay,
on this.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, so my question is, why does specifically the Arab world not have what we can see as a moral courage to clearly denounce ISIS?
Well, I think there's been plenty
of bomb here and bomb there.
No, I think there's been plenty of denunciations. The problem is there's lack of moral credibility, right? So when Bashar al-Assad denounces ISIS, how much moral credibility does he have? Less than zero, right? I mean, the problem is that a political order that's based on despotism and torture and arbitrary killing, et cetera, has no moral credibility to condemn ISIS, and that's the problem. That's why I'm saying it's a political problem, not a theological one. I mean, there are always going to be bad theologies, but bad theologies can only spread when the social conditions allow for it.
I mean, to the extent that we have any kind of spokespeople for the average person, they have also denounced ISIS, but they are powerless.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think there's a problem of a lack of denunciation. It's just that the Arab states, who should be leading the fight against ISIS, lack moral credibility.
Question?
Thank you for your speech. And I have two topics about your speech. The first, I have to say about Rashid Reza and his teachers, Mohammed Abdul. In spite of recent enlightened scholars in Arab countries, the Rashid Reza and his teachers, Mohammed Abdul, emphasize on the text, Quranic text and text of the Hadith. This is important for understanding the differences between Arab scholars in this point. And the other points about ISIS, I think ISIS utilize holy words, for example, jihad and nikah, marriage and jihad. But the problem is the mixed words that use them ISIS. The mixed word isn't holy, isn't, I think, in Farsi, in Arabic, bid'ah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, but the source of the mixed word is holy word in Islam. Important to search about that.
Yeah, I mean, what I would say regarding your last point is that one way to think of ISIS is that you can think of them like Dr. Frankenstein. They've gathered all these different parts that were scattered throughout lots and lots of different books and then put them together into a body that never existed, right? So yes, you can find particular phrases and things like that. And yes, certain people said certain things. Yes, and yes, concubinage existed in early Islamic State, right? But it was never considered a norm or a desirable thing or something like that. It was part of the customary law of the region, so Islam regulated it. But they turn it into an affirmative good deed, right? Because they put it in connection with some sort of apocalyptic goal, which again, as I've said, I've never seen anybody else make a claim like that, right? And so I think you're very right to point that out. As the first point, I'm not sure what exactly you mean. Yes, I agree that Rida and Hamad Abdu tried to say that primacy should be given to the text over the teachings of the jurists. That's right. But they also said that texts always have to be interpreted in light of modern conditions and what's good for the community.
Yes, so, but sorry, I mean, there are limitations for the changes based on the Rashid Reza ideas in spite of the recent enlightened scholar in Islamic countries.
I'm not sure exactly what you mean, but I'll just give an example. Reza said, for example, that the needs of the community trump are more important than any textual command. Because he said that the rules of Islam are of two sorts. There are rules that are ritual between the servant and God. And reason has no role to play with those. So you can't change rules regarding prayer, fasting, etc. You just have to do them. But all other laws, part of mu'amalat, are for the good of human beings. And human beings can understand those rules. So if there is a good reason, we can even contradict express text. Of course, he was saying that in most cases, Muslims were being held back by interpretations, not by the text themselves. He's trying to say, if we actually read the texts, we would realize that they weren't nearly as limiting as the jurists make them out to be. But even if they were, right, we have to understand them in a way consistent with the good of the community, because it's not like worship, right?
Last question. Go ahead.
When you said that ISIS is a product of bad politics, how do you think that the West or like U.S. played a role in it, like pushing Western ideologies and democracy?
I think that's the least significant aspect. That's the least bad aspect of Western policy. I mean, I think the gravest mistakes, of course, were unceasing support for Arab despotism. I mean, that's the most fundamental problem. If I were to criticize the United States, their fanatic attachment to Arab despots. Then, of course, the invasion in 2003, right? I mean, not at all in love with Saddam Hussein. Don't despise the man, right? But to invade Iraq and not have any kind of credible plan for what comes after was grossly, to say the least, negligent. And of course, the United States bears a lot of responsibility for its policies, its acts and omissions. But you know, the purpose of this talk is to think about ISIS from within the Islamic tradition. Right? So yes, the United States and other European powers certainly played a role in the bad politics. But even if we were to say they're primarily responsible, we have to believe that we have agency. I don't know, we as like Arabs or Muslims or whatever. We have to believe that we have enough agency to solve our own problems. And so, I don't want to spend my time casting blame on others, right? Even if they do bear a lot of responsibility.
Let's thank Dr. Fadel one more time.